physics of future colliders, of course. I believe that that came out of TASI lectures early on, right, which then developed into lectures at his university, and it's a very valuable resource. That thing is Royal Arch. It's a beautiful place up here. Some of you may have been there. I was there when I got in on Sunday. I was planning actually to go back later today in the evening, but when it cools down, if some of you want to come up for a fast hike up, we can discuss afterwards, and we can go together. I go fast, but I don't run on that route because it's a bit too much to run. So I start by reviewing where we stand today, and that's easily done, and it was done by George Clooney, who said, Higgs, what else? And that pretty much summarizes the situation we are in. We've seen the Higgs, we're waiting for something else to show up. Even as we wait for this something else to show up, there is still one very short question, which, however, has a lot of deep meaning that we should address. And that is, who ordered that? The question of who ordered that, as you probably know, came up by Izzy Rabi back in the 50s, referring to the muon. You know, what has the muon got to do? And now, you know, this is one of the key elements of our understanding of nature. That's, of course, the Higgs potential. And one of our tasks is to figure out where it comes from. I mean, of course, you could say, well, you know, that's what it is, right? We take it for granted. But I would like to try to induce you into really accepting that there is something very deep and mysterious about this, and that as physicists, we cannot be happy with just leaving it like that. And by doing that, and to do that, I will compare the situation of what we may call the Higgs dynamics, the dynamic of the Higgs boson, with the dynamics of electrons, electrodynamics. In that case, the dynamics is controlled by the potential between two charged particles, Q1, Q2, separated by a distance r. The potential is simply V of r equals to plus Q1 dot Q2 divided by r. Now, let's look at the various elements in this equation. Let us start from Q1 and Q2. There is nothing fundamental there. This is something that we need to measure. That's what defines the Coulomb. This is what, you know, defines the electric charge. We have to go out and measure it. There are subtleties, in fact, that, you know, this number cannot be a continuum. We verified that it is actually quantized. And being quantized, we know some deep reasons why the charge is quantized. For example, if we embed the theory into a grand unified theory, then there are issues like anomaly cancellation is there in general, but in particular, if we embed the theory into a grand unified theory, then there are relations between the charge of a lepton, the charge of a quarks, that link them up and give rise to this need for the charge being quantized. So there is something deep in this numerator. There is something deep in the sign, this plus, because that follows from spin equal to 1. The spin of a photon is equal to 1, and therefore the force between two charges, same sign, is repulsive or is attracted otherwise. There is something deep in the exponent here, r to the first power. This power, 1, and it's 1, it's not 1.000 something, comes from, you may choose whether to call it gauge invariance, charge conservation, the Gauss theorem, Anyway, it's all very, very deep concepts. So everything here is very deep. Of course, we learned of this from the data, but we did discover a very deep underlying origin of each element in this equation, and that depth allow us to project, for example, the embedding of a theory like QED into something even more fundamental. Gauge theories, we know that they can arise, for example, from the compactification of a purely gravitational theory in higher dimensions through the Kaluza-Klein process. Gauge theories arise as the limit of a string theory, and so forth and so on. Okay, so that directly gives us a way into going deeper into the origin of gauge theories. Now, let's do the same for the Higgs. Let's start from this term, minus mu squared. There is no symmetry that tells us that this sign should be plus or minus. There is nothing that guides us into the value of mu, whether it should be large or small or quantized or whatever. It's just whatever it is. Likewise, lambda. There is nothing that tells us whether it should be positive or negative. I mean, of course, it has to be positive because otherwise the potential will not be bounded from below. And here, of course, it has to be negative because otherwise we wouldn't have symmetry breaking. But again, this is something that we realize because we are building this in order to describe symmetry breaking. But why should this be negative? That there is absolutely no reason, right? There are many theories, for example, in grand unified theories, in which supersymmetric grand unified theories, we start from the positive mu squared at the grand unification scale, and that becomes negative out of RG evolution. Even worse, not even these powers are dictated by any symmetry. Because with the symmetry of a theory, the only thing that tells us is that the potentials should be a function of H squared. Because this is the SU2 symmetry of a theory. Of course, you can argue, well, you know, if I want the theory to be renormalizable, then of course this is all I have. Yeah, sure, but first of all, nowadays, a theory being renormalizable, we know that it simply means that if we project to the lowest order, to the dominant dimension operators, all of the operators are, by definition, renormalizables. And it doesn't matter what the potential of the Higgs is. If we look at it, again, in terms of expansion of the dominant operators, we will have a quartic and a quartic term emerging. So again, this is really the simplest and most straightforward thing that you can write. And in fact, there are other places in nature in which we are dealing with a potential like this. And the simplest example is the one of superconductivity. In superconductivity, there is, following Landau-Ginzburg, we do have, as it's true in many other theories in which we have phase transitions, we have a potential, and the simplest representation is this one. There is an order parameter, this field acquires an the order parameter requires an expectation value, and that automatically drives a given phenomenology. In the case of superconductivity, that phenomenology is the photon acquiring a mass as soon as it penetrates through the skin of a superconductor, etc., etc., etc. But you see, in a sense, the Higgs potential we're dealing with, therefore, is at the same level as the Landau-Ginzburg potential. It's nothing deeper than that. With Landau-Ginzburg, in fact, after a decade, there was a step forward. And the step forward was by Cooper in identifying what this order parameter is, that order parameter being Cooper pairs. Electrons pair up, and because of interaction with the lattice and phonons, the internal dynamics of inside the metal under given conditions leads to this. This was proven by BCS. BCS, Bardeen, Cooper, and Schrieffer demonstrated that the dynamics inside the metal leads to that order parameter to acquire an expectation value. And that could be done in the context of the theory itself, which was electrodynamics plus quantum mechanics, of course, plus phonon dynamics, etc. If we try to achieve the same deep understanding of the Higgs potential in the case of a standard model, we cannot. There is no way in the standard model that we can actually prove or construct something like this. By construction, if we want to find the equivalent of BCS for the Higgs, we have to go beyond the standard model. Now, the most straightforward, of course, comparison parallel with BCS would be to claim that the Higgs itself is a composite state. There is an underlying force that binds fermions, etc., etc. That is a possible solution. That is what is called composite Higgs models. But of course, there can be other solutions. And the Higgs indeed could be a very fundamental elementary object whose potential arises from something else, some other dynamics. So, again, the message is that forget about the hierarchy problem of everything else. Just trying to get a deeper understanding of where this comes from automatically forces us to look into physics beyond the standard model. There is, of course, another set of arguments that force us to go towards physics beyond the standard model, and that is the decoupling of short and long distance scales. Again, let's do a parallel between electrodynamics and the Higgs. In QED, we have something marvelous, which is Gauss' theorem. We take a surface around a charge Q. We do the integral on this surface of the gradient of a field of a potential dotted into a surface element. And this is equal to 4 pi times the charge. And this is completely independent of the surface. So if we draw a small surface around the charge or we draw a huge surface around the charge, we get exactly the same number. And in a sense, you can look at this, and of course, this is Gauss' theorem. And Gauss' theorem, in a sense, is what really allows us to separate the physics of short distances and large distances. We cannot have something happening at very, very short distance here, because automatically, through Gauss' theorem, these would have to be transferred to very far distance, because those two integrals have to be exactly the same. So the system is frozen. Another way of saying it is to say that, you know, the charge is not renormalized by the physics at very short distance scales. And this is what guarantees stability, the separation of scales in electrodynamics, the fact that the stability of this table is guaranteed independently of whether there is an extra quark or supersymmetry or anything else, right? It's a purely macroscopic phenomenon. In the case of a Higgs, this doesn't happen. In the case of a Higgs, our couplings, our constants are mu and lambda, and if we go and probe the impact of short distance physics, high frequency modes, we see that those high frequency modes are very strongly coupled to the low frequency modes. For example, if we look at the corrections to mu squared, which is the propagator, the mass self energy of the Higgs, we have corrections in which there is a vector, a gauge boson, so a W, a Z, or the Higgs itself transferred, and then we have corrections where there is the top. And this leads to a normalization, a correction of the mu square term, which is proportional to the cutoff to the high frequency modes that we are looking at, divided by the expectation value square, times contribution that go in the case of the gauge bosons with a coefficient times the mass square of the gauge bosons, or the Higgs boson. And then there is a contribution coming from the top, or in general from the fermions, proportional to a mass of a fermion square with a negative sign. So as you see, this delta mu square proportional to lambda squares is telling us that high frequency modes are strongly coupled to the lowest frequency modes. Mu eventually is the mass of a Higgs. So the ground state of a Higgs is defined by the value of mu. And if we look at lambda, we have exactly the same thing. If we look at the corrections to the self energy, or to the self interaction of the Higgs, we do have contributions coming again from the Higgs itself or gauge bosons, and we have a contribution coming from the top and from all fermions. Of course, this minus sign is a reflection of the fermionic statistics of a loop. That's what gives rise to the minus sign. And here we have the equation for the evolution of lambda versus the log of the scale. And this is proportional to, there is four powers of a mass here, of a mass of a Higgs, with some coefficient, and again, minus a coefficient for the top quark times the mass of the top quark to the fourth power. So you see, again, there is a minus sign. The minus sign, if the top mass is sufficiently large relative to the Higgs mass, as we go to higher and higher modes, these eventually will drive lambda to become negative. And lambda negative, among other things, means that the potential is unbounded from below. And of course, it's very intriguing, the fact that in order for this to saturate, to avoid that lambda becomes negative before we get to, say, the Planck scale or the grand unification scale, the top mass, given the value of the Higgs mass that we measure, the top mass has to be less or about 172. More or less GeV. And the top mass is 173, so it's exactly there. And this is the famous, I'm sure that here I'm saying things that you've seen at least once, and most likely you've seen in Englert lecture last week. So it's quite amazing that the top mass happens to be very, very close to the value at which lambda becomes equal to zero when we go to high energy. Now, but this, anyway, whichever way you turn it, there is here a sickness, there is a sign that high frequency modes are strongly coupled to low frequency modes. Now, this gives rise to what is known as the hierarchy problem. And a way to address this problem is to inject other fields in the theory that somehow cancel this contribution, eliminating the leading terms. Additional fields means new particles. There is nothing inside the standard model that can do it. So once again, we can achieve this by bringing in new particles. New symmetries, for example, that automatically guarantee these cancellations. And this type of solution of a hierarchy problem is what goes under the name of a natural solution. In other words, we don't have to fine-tune parameters, but naturally things cancel out. Again, this calls for theories beyond the standard model. And finally, and independently of the Higgs, we know that we need physics beyond the standard model because there is dark matter, there are neutrino masses, there is dark energy, you name it. So the next steps in high energy physics are to address these two big issues, one understanding the origin of electroweak symmetry breaking, the other to find the origin of the known phenomena beyond the standard model, dark matter, etc. But there is one element, namely that these two directions most likely are not decoupled. There is, at the basis of our projection into the future, on the basis of our thinking of the next generation of facilities, there is this idea that these two problems, the one of the understanding of electroweak symmetry breaking and the origin of dark matter, etc., at the basis, that these two directions are strongly intertwined with each other. So everything that we do when we design new facilities should make sure that it addresses both at the same time. Now, and we do this, of course, with, in the back of our mind, the realization that in spite of all of the expectations, the LHC still hasn't found any new physics. Of course, most of the arguments that were based on natural solutions to the hierarchy problem were suggesting that around the corner, at the electroweak scale, at the scale that's relevant to address these issues, we would have found the new particles that in a natural way solve the hierarchy problem. And that hasn't happened. There is almost 2,000 papers written by the LHC experiments. A fraction of them are about the Higgs. A fraction of them are about measurements of standard model physics, flavor, etc., etc. A large fraction of them is about searches. We've been searching every corner without finding anything. So the question is, how come the LHC has not found this new physics? And there are two obvious answers. One is that the scale of this new physics is just above and beyond what the LHC can address. And the other is that the scale of new physics is actually within the LHC reach, but this new physics manifests itself with phenomena which are particularly elusive, and we haven't been able to see them. And there are examples that now are being pursued by the experiments of possible signatures that so far indeed could have escaped. So as we plan for future facilities, we better make sure that we cover both possible answers. We address both possible answers. And therefore, that requires us to go to higher energy, because if the scale of new physics is beyond LHC, then we do need higher energy. But it also requires that we improve on the front of precision and sensitivity. We have to be able to cover that. One important consideration is that with the discovery of the Higgs, there is no loose theorem any longer. There have been, in the past 30 years, of experimental research in high energy physics have been accompanied by no loose theorems. The SPP-S collider at CERN was built to discover the W and the Z boson. There was no question about that. The Tevatron was built to discover the top. If the top had not been seen at the Tevatron, it would have been that it was much, much heavier, and that was clashing against a lot of indirect evidence coming from precision measurements of electroweak properties, from flavor measurements in B oscillations, for instance, and so forth and so on. And finally, the LHC, and prior to that, the project of the SSC were conceived knowing precisely that either the Higgs would have been discovered or some new physics would have shown up. That made sense because we were working in a context, the standard model, which we felt confident enough was correct and which still needed some elements, some ingredients to be wrapped up. And now that we're moving beyond the standard model, we're moving into the unknown, and therefore there is no guarantee, that there is no experiment that's been planned or that you can plan in the laboratory, accelerators, in the sky, underground. There is no experiment that can promise and guarantee to make a discovery today. We can build an experiment to go after axions, if axions are indeed dark matter and exist, a given experiment can find them in that window. But there is no experiment, for example, that can absolutely discover dark matter independently of whether dark matter is an axion or is a WIMP or is something else. That is absolutely clear. So as we plan, again, for the next facilities, we have to keep this in mind. We cannot prepare something that absolutely guarantees a discovery. Now, for what concerns the future, the immediate future, where by immediate I mean the next 20 years, what we have is the LHC. The LHC has been operating now for 8, 9 years, and the timeline of a future LHC plan includes this year, 2018, in which there is more data taking to achieve a total integrated luminosity of about 130, maybe up to 150 femtobarn, inverse femtobarns. And then 2019 and 2020, there will be a period of shutdown, upgrades of the experiments, upgrades of the accelerator. And then 21, 22, 23, there will be 3 years of operation to achieve a total integrated luminosity of about 300 inverse femtobarns. So this would be about 3 times what we have today. And then there will be a further period of 3 years of significant consolidation of the accelerator. That's what we call the high luminosity HLHC upgrade. And from there on, for the following 10 or 12 years, up to at least 36, there will be a series of runs with a goal of collecting about 3,000 or 4,000 inverse femtobarn. Considering that today most of the papers you find from the LHC are relative to about 36 inverse femtobarns, now we start seeing papers coming out with an update, including the luminosity, the data collected last year. But here you see we're talking about a factor of 100. So the LHC is going to collect 100 times more luminosity, more statistics than it has collected today. And therefore, it's certainly premature to draw any conclusion on whether the LHC has a chance to make discoveries. Of course, it has a chance to make more discoveries beyond the Higgs, because pretty much it has just started. Nevertheless, there are issues that we already know today that unless, again, something surprising happens, but the LHC will not be able to sort out. For example, an important point in the measurement, in the study of a Higgs boson, is the measurement of lambda, of the Higgs self-coupling. The Higgs potential has two parameters, lambda and mu. We have two experimental inputs, which is the expectation value of the Higgs, the famous 246 GeV, which we've known for a long time because it can be measured just through radioactive decays. It's the Fermi constant. And the mass of the Higgs that now we know. So out of these two parameters, in principle, we know both lambda and mu. But the question is, lambda corresponds to the Higgs self-coupling. If we go and we actually measure the strength of the Higgs self-coupling, are we going to find precisely the value of lambda that is predicted in the standard model, or do we find something else? So the measurement of the Higgs self-coupling is absolutely crucial. And even at the end of a high luminosity LHC, and even if we try to be as optimistic as Tillmann and his friends have been in a recent paper where they tried to put in place all of the possible tools using distributions and so forth and so on, at the end of the day, we will be left with an estimate of the coupling lambda divided by the standard model coupling. We will be able to constrain it only within a range that goes from about minus 0.2 to, I guess, 2.6 at 95% confidence level. In particular, this range from minus 0.2 to 2.6, this range covers zero. Okay, so we will not even be able to exclude the possibility that there is no Higgs self-coupling. So that certainly tells us that something so fundamental, so crucial, like the Higgs self-coupling requires going even beyond what I call a short-term or medium-term planning. I call it short-term because at least this has been approved, so it is part of our future path. So, what is what are the requirements that we want to put to a next facility? As I said, we cannot have a guaranteed discovery. But there are important criteria that we can use to judge the value of a proposal. And one is what I call the guaranteed deliverables. Something that you'll be able to get out of this no matter what, even if there is no discovery. And that is the value of measurements. There is a value in making measurements. There are no useless measurements. The only measurements that are useless are those which are wrong. But any correct measurement, sooner or later, will be crucial. And I myself, in my life, I've experienced going through and needing occasionally measurements that, you know, I would have never thought could have any relevance, and that in fact I was saying, you know, who's the person who really spent his life doing this measurement? But then at some point you hit a problem that without that measurement, without that piece of data, you don't know what to do. So there is an immense value in measurements. And if you go back and look at the history of physics, some of the greatest revolutions have really come from very precise, if not boring, measurements. Think about, you know, the precession of Mercury perihelion. That it was not to address and solve a problem that Einstein, of course, discovered general relativity. But once he discovered general relativity, that was the first place to go and verify whether he had something solid or not. So that was absolutely crucial. And there is a long set of measurements that really, a posteriori, you can realize made the history of our field. And we will not know that. And I can give you examples over beer or something really bizarre, okay? Like, for example, why knowing the equation of state of nickel under a pressure of megabars helped the LHC get running. That was related to proving that black holes cannot destroy the Earth, so it was a crucial element. So the second point is, of course, it's not enough to just make measurements for the sake of it. We want to have an extensive discovery potential. I mean, we are building whatever we'll be building to make discoveries. And we want to make sure that what we're proposing is positioned as well as possible to make these discoveries. And the way we assess this is by looking at, broad and well-justified BSM scenarios. Of course, BSM scenarios have been floating around and people have been coming up with new ones for the past 40 years. Since the day the standard model was formulated, the following day, in 74, there was already a grand unification proposed by George I. and Glashow. And since then, of course, we see many things, and none of those so far held, but nevertheless, this is what we have available. So one has to make sure that you cover all of these, and of course, that you are also open to possible discoveries of the unexpected, which means that when you design an experiment and a facility, issues like triggers, which is what tells you what to put to tape, what to record, detector redundancy, making sure that you can actually see things that you haven't planned, say. A good example of this nowadays is this search for long-lived particles. One of the scenarios in which new physics could be hiding is these scenarios in which these new particles of beyond the standard model have a lifetime which is, in the range of microseconds or nanoseconds, so that they do travel. In fact, more than nanoseconds, but they do travel a few centimeters, a meter and a half. They decay in places where you're not used to see particles decaying, and therefore the detectors typically wouldn't trigger on these, and maybe they even have problems, in fact, recording the evidence of a particle that decays 5 meters after the interaction point. So it's important to have all of these, to have these capabilities. And finally, you want to exploit both direct and indirect probes. Direct probes means you have enough energy to go and create a particle. Indirect means you can find out if there is something weird because you do a very precise measurement, for example. Finally, a third ingredient that could be interesting as a way of replacing, if you wish, these no-lose theorems, is to be able to provide some firm yes or no answer. Yes or no answer to some relevant question. Now, the question of whether supersymmetry exists or not is a very interesting question. But we know that we cannot answer yes or no with an experiment because, if you don't find it, you can always say, well, maybe it's one TV heavier, the gluon or the squark, and we keep postponing. At some point, we start worrying whether indeed it makes sense to look for gluons beyond, say, 15 TeV. But again, there is no conclusive statement. But there are other questions on which, in principle, we could make conclusive statements. For instance, the question of whether dark matter is a WIMP. Dark matter, of course, can be many things. It can be neutrinos, it can be axions. Now, we're learning that perhaps it could even be primordial black holes. But it could be WIMPs. And there is a huge effort worldwide to detect dark matter as a WIMP in a range between few GeV and some limit. And the whole point is that if dark matter is a WIMP, a thermal WIMP, there is actually an upper limit. The thing cannot arbitrarily heavy because it has to interact to decay, otherwise it's overproduced, and interact to decay during, of course, the early phase of the universe sets a limit on the interaction strength, and the thing cannot be arbitrarily massive, because otherwise you'd be violating unitarity, etc. So the moment there is an upper limit on something, the question is, can I build an experiment that will explore all the way up to that upper limit? So dark matter, the question of WIMP dark matter, is a good candidate for a question to which we would like to answer yes or no. If the answer is no, because we don't see it, but we can really convince ourselves that we have excluded all of the possibilities of models with WIMP dark matter, then we forget about it and we just go after axions or something else. And there are other examples of these that I will discuss. So what are the facilities that are on the table to address? Yes.
I've been staring at this for a few minutes and for your reason I want to ask my question. I feel like we should be able to say that lambda has to be non-negative, because if you have a negative self-coupling for the Higgs, then what that means is that there's no stable minimum. There's no minimum anywhere.
Yeah.
There's no stable minimum at all for the Higgs potential, and that would be observed. That would cause observational
effects that we haven't seen. You happy? So the question was, correctly, she was pointing out that if lambda were negative, the potential would be unbounded from below and you just don't even start minimizing, because the theory makes no sense. But the whole point, of course, is that we could have higher order corrections that will turn it positive afterwards, right? So we don't really know what lambda is. And one of the points about going and measuring the self-coupling is precisely to verify whether by any chance it is negative. And that automatically would imply that there is something else, like H to the sixth, for example, fixing it. So what are these future colliders we are discussing here? Well, first of all, let me say, it's not that colliders are the only thing that is in the future of our field, right? There is, again, dark matter searches underground in the sky. There is, of course, the whole field of gravitational waves. There are neutrino experiments. There are axion searches, you name it. I'm talking about colliders in the context of these huge facilities in which eventually you really want to put your hands on these physics at high mass. We know that there is physics at high mass because of the problems I highlighted in the case of the Higgs. It's not enough to find indirect evidence for these. We do want to put our hands on it. We wouldn't be satisfied having had just LEP that measured very, very precisely, for example, the range of the top mass. We needed to go to the Tevatron and see the top, because if you don't find the top, the fact that another experiment indirectly tells you where the top mass is absolutely meaningless, because that only makes sense in the context of the theory within which you correlate the mass of the top with your observables. But the whole point of the game is to see whether there is something else. Okay, so it's absolutely essential to go after this mass case. And after all, you know, our field is driven by going to smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller distance case, and that we achieve by going to higher energies and therefore building bigger accelerators. So what is on the table today when we talk about the future is the famous ILC, the International Linear Collider. It's any plus E minus collider. Add the energies of 250 GeV. So this is at the peak of the production for Higgs bosons. With an upgrade path going to 500 and eventually possibly to 1 TeV. And this is now being discussed in Japan, and hopefully by the end of this year, the Japanese government will tell us whether they intend to proceed with this project. CLIC is also an E plus E minus linear collider. It's proposed by CERN. It's a completely different technology, but it's E plus E minus collisions. It will start at 380 GeV. Because of its technology, it cannot go low in energy. So 380 is the minimum at which it becomes meaningful to operate this machine. And then there will be an upgrade to 1.5 and possibly up to 3 TeV. The timescale for the discussion of the possible approval of this accelerator is not defined. In Europe, there will be a discussion of European facilities in the course of 2019 and 20, but it's very hard to imagine that a decision will be taken, so most likely we'll go to the following discussion of a strategy, which will be 5 or 6 years after that. What we are discussing nowadays with great emphasis, and what I will focus my lectures on, is what we call FCC, which is Future Circular Colliders. They're built around a new 100-kilometer tunnel that could host any plus E minus circular collider, like LEP, operating at a whole series of energies at 91 GeV, to replicate with much extended statistics the LEP program, 160 GeV, W pair production, 240 GeV, the peak of the Higgs production rate, and 365 GeV to do top anti-top production just above the threshold. Once you're done with the plus E minus, you can put in a 100 TeV proton-proton collider. So 7 times the energy of the LHC. Notice that the LHC is 27 kilometers, so the tunnel is only 4 times bigger, but we go 7 times bigger in energy. And we can achieve that because we are almost doubling the strength of the dipoles, of the magnets that keep the protons in orbit. And then there is the option as well of including EP, which is the equivalent of HERA, in a sense. It would be an experiment mostly focused on the better understanding of a proton structure, of parton densities, etc., but also with some relevance in the program of measuring the Higgs. There is a similar project called CEPC in China. At the end of the day, it's the same program. And then there is something else, which is called the high-energy LHC, which is LHC at 27 TeV. And this uses the same magnets that are being planned for FCC. You see, these are 16 Tesla magnets. A 16 Tesla magnet allows you to put 1 TeV per kilometer in the machine. So the LHC tunnel is 27 kilometers, and therefore you get 27 TeV. So it's almost a doubling of the energy of the LHC. You know, just to discuss these facilities, aside from the physics, is extremely exciting, because underlying all of these, there is a technology which is mind-boggling and which does require a lot of time to be developed, and which is fascinating also from the point of view, from the perspective of a physicist. There is a sociology, because we're talking about projects that you know, will not come to life, if at all, before 30, 40, maybe 50 years. How do we keep the field going in these 50 years? There is politics, because they cost, you know, immense amounts of money. All of these things are relevant, because they play a role. These are elements that we cannot forget. It's not enough to have a project that does good physics if we cannot address these issues. And this is why we thought with Tillman that, since I don't want to contaminate the physics lectures with that discussion, but still, if there is interest in this informal meeting that could be Thursday evening at 7 o'clock after the dinner, we could just go through all of these more sociological, political, technological issues. I'd be happy to talk about the technology. If I have time, I will also do it in my last lecture. Anyway, so that's the... This is to explain what that session is. So that's the general introduction. And now, my main focus will be the 100 TV collider. So we go back to talking about hadronic collisions. And, you know, 100 TV, 27 TV, 14 TV, pretty much it's all the same ball game, right? To the extent that we are focused on hard interactions, high Q square, we're not dealing with the details like, you know, the elastic cross-section or the total cross-section phenomena which are non-perturbative in origin, where we don't understand anything at 14 TV and we understand even less at 100 for that matter. But the parts where we do understand at 14 TV, which is high Q square phenomena, production of W, Z, Higgs, tops, et cetera, those we know equally well at 100 TV, perhaps more or less. Question? Because the way click accelerates electrons becomes mostly efficient as you go to higher energies. The click electrons are accelerated not by a radio frequency cavity like ILC, but are accelerated by a field, an electromagnetic field, which is collected inside cavities by sending a pilot beam before. The pilot beam goes through, radiates, and creates this wave within which then the electron beam of the accelerator. So this does require higher energies. Already to go down to 380 was not straightforward. The lowest energy that at the very beginning was conceived was actually TeV. So they had to do some work to get down to 380. It's a compromise with luminosity. You want to have enough luminosity to make it interesting, and that cannot be achieved if you were to go down to 250 GeV. Yes. That's a good question. Yes. So the question is whether CLIC and FCC, which are both supposed to be hosted at CERN, conflict with each other. And of course they do, because they are both big projects, very expensive, and eventually a choice will be made between one of the two. Yeah, so I was saying, as we discussed the physics of 100 TV, the very basics, somehow, are not different than those of the LHC. So many of the things that I will say are valid for either collider. But I will start by just showing how things project. What is the gain that we get by going to higher energy, which, of course, is trivial because there is more energy, but it's, in fact, more subtle, because the real question is how much more events can we create, for example? How do we use them? Is it just being more powerful, or does a 100 TV machine allow us to be also smarter? And that is one of the things, one of the messages that I would like to convey. So I will start from a very basic issue, which is I will talk about PDFs. So the quark and gluon densities inside the proton, because this is what drives the key differences between 14 and 100 TV. And to do that, I need a short prelude on kinematics and definitions. Part of this has been done by Frank, but allow me to do it again, just to fix the notation. So there is an important quantity that we will be using throughout and will become relevant when we discuss parton luminosities, which is the rapidity. And the rapidity of a system with momentum P and energy E is given by half the logarithm of the energy plus the momentum. The rapidity is defined with respect to a direction. So we take three-dimensional space, we have a direction and we have a transverse plane. So the transverse coordinates, momenta are in the transverse plane, and in this longitudinal direction, we define the rapidity. So E plus P divided by E minus P parallel. In the context of a system produced in the collision, where we have our two beams with partons carrying momentum x1, that's the momentum fraction of a proton coming from one side, and x2, that's momentum fraction coming from the other side, we create a system of moment of n of mass, invariant mass m. We define the variable tau, which is equal to m squared divided by 4 e beam square. This is what we call also capital S. It's the proton-proton center of mass square. And tau is equal to x1 times x2. This is a small exercise that you can do yourself. And using this variable x1 and x2, the rapidity of a system produced by the collision is equal to 0.5 log of x1 divided by x2. So one thing that you can prove when we start writing phase space, for example, is that dp parallel divided by the energy p0, which is one of the components of the Lorentz invariant phase space, is actually equal to dy. The reason why rapidity is interesting is because rapidity is additive under Lorentz boosts. So if I move to a different Lorentz frame, then energy and momentum, of course, get boosted. Say that beta is the factor, the Lorentz factor in the boost. That leads to a shift in rapidity. If I look at the rapidity into the new frame, this goes to the rapidity plus 0.5 log of 1 plus beta divided by 1 minus beta. This is another exercise that you can do. So you see the shift in rapidity is totally independent of the momentum, the mass of the object. It's really something specific of the reference frame. And in particular, that means that the rapidity difference, if I have two particles traveling at different rapidities, the rapidity difference will be independent of the frame. So it is a Lorentz invariant quantity. And in fact, this is the basis for realizing that dp over p0 equal to dy is Lorentz invariant. So there is a geometric interpretation of the rapidity in the case of a massless particle. And this, again, is a small exercise that you can easily do. Y equals to 0.5 log of E plus P parallel divided by E minus P parallel. If a particle is massless, then the energy is equal to the norm of a momentum. So if we produce a particle at an angle theta relative to the beam line, this becomes 0.5 log of 1 plus cos theta divided by 1 minus cos theta. And you can work this out, and you get 0.5. Sorry, you get minus log of a tangent of theta divided by 2. So the rapidity for a massless particle is something that only depends on the production angle. So that is this is what we typically call the pseudo-rapidity. And it is a very useful variable, because when you build a detector, the detector has a geometric acceptance. The detector does not have acceptance in rapidity, but it has acceptance geometric, within rapidity minus plus or minus 2.5, for instance. So notice that at angle equals to 90 degrees, both rapidity and pseudo-rapidity are equal to zero. So rapidity zero means at 90 degrees. So as a simple application of this, which is actually cute, we can look at a particle of mass m, which is moving with a given rapidity y in your lab frame, and this particle at some point decays to two particles. Let's call it p1 and p2. So the rapidity, just because the rapidity is additive, it means that the rapidity of p1 in the lab frame will be equal to the rapidity of a particle m plus the rapidity of a particle p1 in the m rest frame. Okay? Since the particle in the rest frame m decays, one particle goes forward and another goes backward, it means that the rapidity of the two particles in the lab frame will just be obtained as y, the rapidity of the massive particle, plus or minus the rapidity in the rest frame of a decay particle. In particular, this means that if the particle m decays at 90 degrees in its rest frame, the rapidity of a decay particles will be exactly the same as the rapidity of a particle. And this also means that if we do an experimental analysis in which we need both particles to be within a given rapidity range, that's the pseudo-rapidity range, that is the acceptance of our detector, it means that the maximum rapidity of a particle m that we are sensitive to is the pseudo-rapidity acceptance of a detector. For example, if we look at production of Z bosons going to E plus E minus, and we have a detector that only sees electrons within plus or minus 2.5 in pseudo-rapidity, that means that we will only be able to see Z bosons with rapidity within plus or minus 2.5. Okay? So these are simple considerations. You can work out those exercises yourself. So let's come back now to the equation that was written by Frank earlier for the cross sections. So d sigma equals to the integral in dx1, dx2. F of x1, f of x2 times a Partonic cross section. I will not put indices I, j, it's understood that those appear when relevant. Now, let's call S hat equals m squared the mass of a system that we are producing. You can show as an exercise that this integration measure dx1, dx2, you formulate it in terms of rapidities and the variable tau, which I remind you is equal to m squared divided by s. We can write dx1, dx2 like dy, d tau, or dx1 over x1 times d tau. So either of these is acceptable. And that means that we can transform this equation into the following relation. D sigma equals to the integral in d tau over tau that multiplies a quantity tau dl by d tau times d sigma hat, where this quantity dl by d tau is equal to the integral between y mean, the minimum and the maximum rapidity range. You should imagine these objects that we are producing, of course, depending on x1 and x2, will be moving along the beam lines. So is equal to the integral in dy of f calculated at the value x1, f calculated at value x2. Or we can also write these as the integral in dx over x, f of x, f of tau divided by x, from tau to 1. In other words, we are producing our object with a mass m, and then we just integrate over all of the possible configurations in which this object is moving along the beam lines compatible with the kinematic constraints, that there is only so much energy available. Now, this relation is interesting because d sigma hat, of course, refers to the partonic cross-section, to the partonic process. So it doesn't care about whether, let's say, it's a W production. It doesn't care whether the W is being produced at 14 TV, 50 TV, 100 TV. It's just the process of producing out of a quark-antiquark a W, or out two gluons a Higgs. The quantity d tau over tau is also independent of the of a beam energy, because tau is equal to m squared divided by s. So d tau over tau cannot depend on s. And that means that all of the only place where the information about the beam energy appears is tau dl by d tau. So namely, this convolution of PDFs. So if we want to calculate how the cross-section for a given process evolves as a function of energy, it's enough that we calculate this thing. We don't need to know anything about the sigma hat. How much the cross-section to produce a Higgs or a TT bar pairs or a W changes going from 14 TV to 100 TV, we can determine simply by calculating this object here, because this part remains the same. Of course, this is true to the extent that we are not applying fancy cuts on the kinematics of the final states, because those would, if we say that we only see electrons, for example, within rapidity one, well, that of course has a different impact in terms of efficiency, whether we are at 14 TV or 100 TV. But if we are talking about the global properties, the total cross-section for some hard process, what I said is correct. So what we'll be doing now is to study in some more detail this function dl by d tau, which is called the partonic luminosity. Because it counts, it measures the flux of partons in the initial state. So let's do it by going through an example first. And we take the simplest example, which is also one that Frank went through today, so I can spare some parts. And that is a process, a 2-to-1 process. So we are just producing one body in the final state. So this could be production of a W, a Z, or a Higgs. So d sigma hat, the partonic cross-section, will be equal to 1 over 2m squared, where m is the mass of the particle that we are producing. So this is the flux from the initial state. And then the phase space of the final state, there is only one object. So it's d3q divided by 2 pi cube, 2q0, 2 pi to the fourth, delta 4 of q minus p in. OK? So the way you deal with this expression is to take d3q over 2q0, which is Lorentz invariant, and we rewrite this as d4q. So we remove the constraint of being on shell, and we impose it through a delta function, which is delta of q square minus, of course, p in square. And p in square is equal to the mass square of our particle, of course. So d4q eats up the delta function, and there is some 2 pi's that cancel each other, etc. So we end up with d sigma hat equals to 1 pi over m square delta of tau s minus m square. And of course, there is the matrix element square, which I forgot to put in here. The matrix element you can find for say for the W, you can find it from Frank notes. Just notice that for a 2-to-1 process, from dimensional analysis, the dimensions of a matrix element square is 2. So this is dimension mass square. And this is right, because mass square, the delta function of the mass square is dimension minus 2. So this goes like 1 over m square, which is the correct dimensions for a cross section. So when we plug this into the hadronic cross section, we have the integral in d tau over tau. We have tau dl over tau. And then we put in d sigma hat, which is pi over m square delta of tau s minus m square times the matrix element square. So delta tau, we can write as delta tau s divided by tau s. D tau s with a delta goes away. And we are left, tau s is equal to the mass square. So what we have is pi over m to the fourth, the matrix element square, which has dimension 2. So this combination goes like, and typically, for example, for QQ bar goes to a W, or for glu glu goes to Higgs, it's proportional to the square of a particle. So this expression goes like 1 over the mass of a particle squared times tau dl in the tau, which again it was written there. So out of these, we can do the total cross section. The luminosity, as you see, is an integral in rapidity, and therefore we can also obtain simply the rapidity distribution of a W by eliminating this integration. So that tells us that d sigma in dy, the rapidity distribution of this object, will be equal to pi over m to the fourth matrix element square times tau f of x1, f of x2, where x1 and x2, you can prove, are equal to square root of tau e to the plus or minus y. So this is a number. Okay, because if I fix the rapidity, there is nothing left, and there is only one. If I fix the mass and the motion of this particle, there is only one combination of x1 and x2 that enforces that kinematics. And out of this, and of course, if you want sigma, we do the integral. So if we want to move forward at this point, this is known. We have to know something about these f's. So let us make some assumption about those. You saw from Frank that if, you know, we were dealing with photons, f of x would be equal to 1 over x. This is the Bremsstrahlung spectrum. This is the question that he asked you already at the beginning of this lecture this morning, to make sure that you had followed. Now, in the case of gluons, for example, we know that, and we will see it explicitly in a second, well, tomorrow at this point, that that there is a higher exponent. It doesn't go like 1 over x, it goes faster when X becomes small. And that's because when a gluon is when a photon is emitted, it just goes away. So the spectrum with which it's emitted is the spectrum that we maintain at the end of the day. When I emit a gluon and the emission of a gluon goes like 1 over X, that gluon itself will radiate and will split into further gluons. And therefore, the momentum will become smaller. So I will be populating even more the small X gluon component of the proton. So let's parameterize f of x as 1 over x to the alpha, with alpha typically bigger than 1, but also alpha strictly smaller than 2. Because if we do the integral in dx of x, which is the momentum carried by the gluon, times the gluon density, this is supposed to be the average momentum, the total momentum carried by gluons, and the total momentum carried by gluons cannot be bigger than the momentum of a proton. So this number should be smaller than 1, but if I put in f of x, that goes like 1 over x alpha with alpha bigger than 2, of course this will diverge. There will be an infinite amount of momentum carried by low x gluons. So there is no way that alpha can be bigger than 2. And the Altarelli-Parisi equation guarantees that that's the case, and you should do it as an exercise by going back to the equations that Frank gave you and prove that this exponent cannot be bigger than 2. But if we take this and we put it back, look at what happens. It's very cute. Because let's write these in terms of those variables. So f of square root of tau e to the y, f of square root of tau e to the minus y, and now we put in this, so this is equal to 1 divided by tau to the alpha over 2 e to the alpha y. This is equal to tau to the alpha over 2 e to the minus alpha y, and this is equal to 1 over tau to the alpha. So that means that d sigma by dy is equal to pi over m to the fourth m square times tau divided by tau to the alpha. Alpha, we can write it as 1 plus delta to signal that it's bigger than 1, smaller than 2. So delta is by how much it's bigger than 1. So tau over tau alpha means 1 over tau to the delta. So this is the differential d sigma in dy. And you see, it's a constant. It's just a number. It doesn't depend on y. We've lost all of the y dependence. So this distribution, the distribution of a W or a gluon or whatever, to the extent that the parton density scales like 1 over x to some power, it doesn't matter what the power is a distribution which is flat, of course, within the rapidity range that's allowed by the kinematics. And you can calculate on the basis of that equation that y max is equal to 0.5 log of 1 over tau. So this is the range. Okay, so the prediction following from this is that independently of what this exponent is, the rapidity distribution will be flat. If we integrate in rapidity, it's trivial, it's just the rapidity range. So sigma will be equal to pi over m to the fourth, m square, 1 over tau to the delta, and the rapidity range is twice the maximum rapidity. That's the extension, how big this is, and that is equal to log of 1 over tau. So this is telling us how how the cross-section grows with energy. It grows like a log. Tau, I remind you, is m squared divided by s, right? So this is, goes like the log of a beam energy divided by the mass. I increase the energy and it grows logarithmically with a correction which goes like tau to the delta. So if you want to see it in terms of s's, sigma k is like s divided by m squared to the delta times the log of s divided by m squared. And this is a very general prediction, which is relatively simple to obtain, and that right away gives us a sense of how quickly cross sections grow. So I stop here because I see that the time is, in fact, I'm over my time, and we will take it from here tomorrow, going in some more detail and correcting, of course, the behavior, because in reality things behave differently, and then we will see what this means in terms of extrapolating cross sections for relevant processes from 14 to 100 TeV.